I will now call on Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf to speak to and move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. COVID-19 has profoundly impacted families right across our country, with loved ones unfortunately dying as a result of this terrible virus. It's a loss that has been compounded by the necessary societal restrictions in place, not least I can think of the harm that has been done to families who have had to miss, for example, funerals of a loved one. I want to offer my sympathies, and I'm sure those of the whole chamber, to those that have lost a loved one, a relative or a friend. While the pandemic has not gone, our NHS vaccine programme and the efforts of the people of Scotland has drastically and dramatically reduced the impact on our NHS. However, I don't think anybody does, and we should never underestimate the significant challenge that responding to COVID has had on our NHS. While someone may not have had COVID-19 themselves, this pandemic may well have impacted their health in other ways, both physical and mental. Before I go into details of my thanks to our NHS staff, can I say what an honour it is to be taking part in this debate, to be opening this debate, and to have been appointed Health Secretary. I suspect all of us across this chamber will have our own stories of how the Health Service, the National Health Service, has impacted our lives. I'm sure we'll hear some of those stories today. I know when people have asked me over the last 2 weeks how I felt about being appointed Health Secretary, I've often said to them that I'm somewhat daunted by it, and that's how it should be. Being entrusted with the health of the nation is a huge responsibility during normal times, let alone while still in the midst of a global pandemic. And during my first visit as Health Secretary last week, my first official visit, I heard firsthand from the staff at Monklands Hospital about how they responded to the challenges of the pandemic. My first debate as Health Secretary last week, I put on record my thanks and admiration for the exceptional care all NHS and social care staff have delivered through this pandemic. Our NHS and care staff have indeed answered the nation's call at a time of greatest need. Their efforts on testing and vaccination have been incredible. They've been and are the bedrock on which we build our national recovery. More than 5 million doses of the vaccine have been administered in Scotland, with over 2 million people having had both jabs. And as of today, 99% of people aged 50 and over have had their first dose. And we remain on track to complete all first doses by the end of July, if not, hopefully, possibly even earlier. In response to the higher levels of COVID-19 in Glasgow, the Health Board have opened up walk-in clinics to help speed up getting vital second doses into as many people over the age of 40 as possible. Of course I will.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way, and I'm very grateful to the engagement he's offered me about the outbreaks in Davidson's, Mains and Silver Knowes in my constituency. Given that he has offered in hotspot areas of Glasgow walk-in vaccinations for those who have not yet been offered their first or second jab, would he make that same provision available to my constituents?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, of course, that would be a decision for the local health board. I spoke to Lothian Health Board, both the chair and the chief executive, last week. I'm speaking to the chief execs again tomorrow. I will certainly impress upon them that I think there is great merit in walk-in and drop-in clinics. We've seen, for example, over the weekend, an additional 1,700 people getting vaccinated on top of those who were scheduled for appointments over the course of Saturday and Sunday. I would like to see these drop-in clinics, walk-in clinics, being extended right across the country. So I'll impress upon Lothian Health Board when I discuss this matter with chief executives tomorrow. Our NHS has continued to provide care, ensuring those with the most urgent needs were treated. But we have to be frank about the impact that the pandemic has had on the NHS. That's why within 100 days of this government, we're going to publish an NHS recovery plan that aims to not only restore activity to previous levels, but crucially, as many members across the chamber have urged us to do, to exceed them. We will work with the front line to design and implement sustainable ways of ensuring people are seen more quickly while maintaining quality of care. We'll not wait for the recovery plan to be published to remobilise our NHS. We've already opened our first of the three new fast-track cancer diagnostic centres in NHS Dumfries and Galloway. It's already started seeing patients, with the other two centres opening their doors within a matter of a few weeks. Since screening programmes resumed in August last year, almost 300,000 patients have had their breast and cervical screening. Pausing the national screening programmes was one of the most difficult decisions this government has had to make. That is why the safety of patients, the public and indeed staff is our priority as we now deliver and expand. It's crucial that we detect cancer early, so it's vital that people don't ignore their invites, and anyone with concerns or symptoms should contact their GP practice without any delay. Plans to remobilise local services with focus on supporting staff wellbeing, embedding sustainability are now being implemented. In NHS, Ayrshire and Arran, that has included the Scottish Government funding the buyout of the PPP East Ayrshire Community Hospital that was announced by the First Minister last week. I'm clear that the recovery of our services will not be possible without the recovery of our workforce. A range of wellbeing and mental health resources have been put in place locally, which staff tell us they value. These are being supplemented by national resources, such as the National Wellbeing Hub, which now has had over 100,000 users, and the National Wellbeing Helpline. It is, of course, easy for us all to clap our hands, to embrace the NHS staff with warm words, but we are determined as a government to show them through our actions how much we value them. We will build capacity for recovery by better managing unscheduled demand. This is where our GPs and primary care sector are vital, releasing capacity in our hospitals. Primary care are best placed to maintain care within a person's home. Linking GPs as our expert medical generalists with their acute sector colleagues will improve referral and discharge. This will be central to ensuring people suffering with long COVID, I know an issue important to many people across the chamber, that they get the range of services they need. Our multidisciplinary approach to primary care will empower our frontline nursing staff. We will increase pharmacy support in GP practices. That will allow medication and polypharmacy reviews to support self-care. We must also increase training and recruitment of first contact physiotherapists to meet anticipated increase in musculoskeletal issues. And we'll further increase investment in community link workers. I know many of us have seen the value of those link workers in our own constituencies. We will further increase that investment to ensure every GP practice has access to a mental wellbeing link worker to better deliver social prescribing. We shouldn't lose sight of just how critical digital technology has been to our pandemic response. The use of the Near Me video consulting service, it rose from around 300 consultations pre-pandemic to over 20,000 per week now. Its utility has seen it now being adopted as an approach in England and Wales too. I should stress that digital and telephony services are, of course, a great tool for our NHS, but that people seeing medical professionals in person will clearly continue to be vital to the care that we provide. In recent years, there has been a welcome shift in the provision of inpatient treatment towards day cases. We will continue to make greater use of our community hospitals. For example, we provided targeted investment in NHS Lothian to make greater use of the theatre capacity at East Lothian Community Hospital. Our resilience and ability to increase elective activity is aided by expanding our ICU capacity. We've increased investment in ICU throughout COVID, and will increase ICU beds from 173 to at least 203 on a permanent basis. Of course, the NHS remains able to double the national adult ICU capacity to 360 beds within 1 week, and to treble it within 3 weeks to 585 beds, should it be required. A challenge that the UK government could help address is the effect pension changes have had on disincentivising NHS consultants from engaging in waiting times initiatives. I have today written to the UK Chancellor Rishi Sunak to seek early discussions with the UK Government and the BMA on doctors' annual allowance and lifetime allowance for pensions, in order that flexibility is allowed to encourage greater activity with leading to punitive tax charges for doctors. In terms of mental health and wellbeing, I know this is an issue that has been raised by many members across the chamber in the last couple of weeks, and I wanted to address some of those issues, although my colleague, the Minister for Mental Wellbeing, Kevin Stewart, will no doubt elaborate on this in his closing speech. And mental wellbeing is, of course, just as important as, of course, physical health. People who may never have been affected by mental health issues are now facing emotional distress due to the impact of the pandemic. Our NHS recovery plan will include action on improving mental health and wellbeing services, and we will increase direct investment in mental health by 25% over the course of the Parliament. Of course they will.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for taking an intervention. Mental health funding in England and Wales sits at roughly 11% of the overall health budget, yet in Scotland it's something like 8.5%. Will he get it to 11% by the end of this Parliament?
I'm sure Jackie Bailey is grateful for the Cabinet Secretary taking an intervention, but I would appreciate it if she'd wait to be called by the Chair. Cabinet Secretary to respond.
Forgive her, Presiding Officer, she is new to this, not much experience. We will commit, as we did in our manifesto, to increase that spend by the lifetime of this Parliament to 10%, and we have already increased some of our additional spending in relation to mental health, and we'll continue to do that, particularly if there are further COVID consequentials that come our way. So there will be a substantial increase in mental health spend, and already some of that spend is making its way to Health Board to address, for example, the waiting times in relation to CAMHS. As well as mental health services, within our first 100 days, we'll also publish a women's health plan to tackle inequalities by raising awareness around women's health and improving access to healthcare for women throughout their lives. And Marie Todd will take this work forward as the First Minister to have a dedicated focus on women's health. Within the first 100 days, we'll also bring forward a bill to enable the reimbursement for those who have paid to have mesh removal surgery out with the NHS, and I look forward to working with members across the Chamber to implement this. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, our commitment to create a national care service will deliver services founded on fairness, equality and human rights and placed on the same level of esteem as our national health service. This will be the most significant public sector reform since the creation of the NHS in 1948 and will be operational within the five-year lifetime of this Parliament. In our first 100 days, we will begin the consultation on the necessary legislation with a view to introducing it in the first year of this Parliament. We will also establish a social covenant steering group, including those with lived experience who use our care services, to ensure that they are part of the co-design process. I look forward to working across the Chamber to protect and support our National Health Service and create and develop our National Care Service. I know that everyone across this Chamber cherishes and values the work of our NHS and care staff and all that they have done in this pandemic. Presiding Officer, there are many voices with experience in and of our health and care service in our Parliament. I look forward to hearing them during this debate, and together we have an opportunity to develop a very broad consensus on how our NHS recovers from the pandemic. As Health Secretary, my door will always be open to positive ideas coming from right across the Chamber for improving the care that we give our nation. And I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call Annie Wells, who joins us remotely, to speak to and move Amendment 144.4 in her name. Annie Wells, you have 7 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am grateful to be given the opportunity to speak to the Scottish Conservatives Amendment in my name and to the Government's motion. I wish to extend the condolences from my party to all those that have lost a loved one due to COVID. We welcome the commitment from the Government to produce an NHS recovery plan within 100 days, but we are keen to go further. As the vaccine programme continues to roll out across Scotland and the UK, it is giving us further confidence that we can soon put this pandemic behind us and return to a life that resembles normality. In the meantime, I am sure this chamber is entirely united in expressing our continued gratitude to our fantastic NHS staff. Presiding Officer, although we are making substantial progress against containing COVID, we cannot afford to turn our attentions away from other significant challenges. Indeed, some of these challenges may be with us a long time after the immediate effects of the pandemic have passed. And it truly is remarkable and a testament to their dedication that over these past 14 months, NHS staff have treated thousands of sick COVID patients. However, as I said in the Chamber last week, the NHS backlog is at great risk of spiralling out of control. If urgent action is not taken, we could be heading for a full-blown healthcare crisis. As borne out by the latest Public Health Scotland statistics, around 28,000 patients have spent 52 weeks or more on an NHS list awaiting planned hospital treatment. And it's also true that, as of March 2021, around 100,000 Scots are still waiting on key diagnostic tests. We have already heard stark warnings from leading charities such as Cancer Research UK about the impact this could have upon tens of thousands of Scots across the country. As part of the pledges in our manifesto, the Scottish Conservatives had committed to an additional £600 million to tackle the NHS treatment backlog in 2021-22. Crucially, we also called on the SNP government to speed up the delivery of early cancer diagnostic centres, and I am pleased to see that this is now being delivered, and also prioritise boosting the diagnostic workforce. This is key to tackling the hidden backlog of those who are yet to be referred due to the pandemic. There is no doubt that the NHS backlog will be a source of acute concern for those waiting longer for care and treatment, as well as their families and loved ones. Therefore, it is a welcome step that the Scottish Government have pledged to produce an NHS recovery plan. However, we have stressed that the promise to increase in inpatient, day case and outpatient activity must not come at the expense of the time consultants are able to spend with a single patient. Given the immense gravity of this challenge, tackling the NHS backlog must be a top priority for this new Parliament going forward. As such, we cannot spend the next 5 years stuck in the same debates and disagreements that held back the last Parliament. Presiding Officer, I also recognise, like many aspects of our society and economy, COVID-19 has had some tremendous impact on our social care system. We welcome the Feely Review and support many of the recommendations put forward to Scotland's social care system to put Scotland's social care system on a more sustainable footing. And as I made clear last week, I very much look forward to working with the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, councils, families and providers on this matter in the weeks ahead. The Scottish Conservatives have also repeatedly called for an immediate judge-led inquiry to uncover the truth into what happened in our care homes, where over 3,000 people tragically lost their lives. I recognise the incredibly tough job ministers have had during the pandemic, but grieving families deserve answers from those responsible for making those key decisions as soon as possible. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Conservatives are calling for a women's health plan to be brought forward within 100 days, and I was pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary say that Marie Todd will take this forward. Because as we remobilise the NHS, we need to better shape the services that are needed by women of all ages, but have often fallen short in the past. On an issue spearheaded by my colleague Jackson Carlow, we also believe that we are calling for a bill on the restitution for victims of the mesh scandal, and I look forward to working across the chamber with the Cabinet Secretary on this issue. Presiding Officer, as the Scottish Conservatives' motion makes clear, we want to see this government make a serious commitment toward tackling Scotland's drug death crisis. We have appealed for cross-party support to tackle drug deaths by opening up access to treatment and rehab programmes. In this spirit, I welcome the number of funding announcements made last week by the Minister for Drugs Policy. It is a welcome first step, but much more needs to be done to tackle this crisis, which, quite frankly, is Scotland's shame. I look forward to working with other parties across the chamber on this vital matter, as I am determined to build a consensus around new legislation to ensure no one is denied the rehab support they need. To sum up, Presiding Officer, although I welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to an NHS recovery plan, I believe we could go further in certain areas. I will continue to make the case that this Parliament's head must be strictly focused on tackling our various health emergencies, and I will also work with any member across the chamber who believes Scotland's recovery must come first. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Ms Wells. I now formally call on Jackie Bailey to speak to and move Amendment 144.1 on behalf of Scottish Labour. Ms Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. You're clearly worth a watching. Even before COVID-19, health services were struggling to keep up with demand and there was a growing backlog of care. The pandemic has made things worse. It's exacerbated existing inequalities. So we need to understand the scale of the challenge we face. More than 290,000 people had waited more than the 12-week treatment time guarantee before the pandemic. Now that figure has reached 400,000. The 62-day waiting time standard for urgent cancer referrals has never been met since 2012. Public Health Scotland tell us that there have been 7,000 fewer cancer diagnoses in 2020. So thousands are living with undiagnosed conditions. Some may have indeed died. Almost 106,000 patients waiting for a diagnostic test, an increase of 25%, and almost 5,000 of them have waited over a year for an endoscopy. The 18-week waiting time for mental health services has never been met. Thousands of young people are still being rejected from specialist CAM services. Deaths from suicides are rising, and our mental health has worsened during the pandemic. Today's mental health statistics highlight the stark reality facing many people across Scotland, and it is shameful. The NHS has been underfunded for years, demand is increasing, and we don't have the staff to cope. So we are facing a perfect storm. The warnings from respected stakeholders like the Royal College of General Practitioners and the BMA are stark. They tell of GPs and NHS staff who are burnt out. Having worked on the front lines throughout the pandemic, some are now taking early retirement. They talk about workload pressures, the lack of staffing, the lack of resources. Now, we all agree that we need to remobilise the NHS and catch up on the backlog quickly. But we cannot begin to do that unless we take care of the staff, because they are the backbone of the NHS, and without them, we have nothing. Like everyone who's spoken so far, I thank NHS and social care staff for everything that they've done to keep us safe. But they need more than our thanks. They need our support and they need action. So when the Royal College of General Practitioners says they need action on workforce planning or a mental health worker in every general practice, please listen and please act. They were promised multidisciplinary teams in GP surgeries, but that's been implemented at snail's pace. They cannot wait any longer. And when the BMA calls out the fact that consultant vacancies are deliberately underreported and says that staff well-being needs to be a priority, then please listen and please act. This Scottish Government have not been good at workforce planning. No, indeed it was Nicola Sturgeon as Health Minister that cut the training places for doctors and nurses that have led to the crisis we face now. So we need to immediately increase the number of training places for doctors, nurses and allied health professionals. But we need to do more than that to retain staff now. The task is huge and the Labour Health team will work with the Cabinet Secretary to try and make things better. But we will also be critical if we feel he is getting things wrong. So let me turn to one area where there are real concerns, and that is cancer. The pause in the screening programmes has meant that as many as 7,000 people could have cancer that have not been diagnosed. We all know that early diagnosis and treatment gives the best outcomes. Yet waiting times are far too long. The number of people waiting for diagnostic tests has risen. It's 20% higher than pre-pandemic levels. We know that cancer is higher in deprived communities. People are usually diagnosed later and their outcomes are therefore poorer. As Macmillan point out, we need urgent action to deliver the cancer services plan, but we cannot simply return to pre-pandemic levels of activity as we need to deal with increased numbers. I'm sorry, I've got a lot to get through. The First Minister said to this chamber that we would use capacity from wherever we can find it. And I agree with her. So how disappointing to learn from the minutes of the National Cancer Recovery Group on the 19th of March that the majority of private sector capacity will cease at the end of March. The same minute expressed concern from clinicians about the impact of the loss of this additional capacity. This at the same time as urgent breast cancer referrals are currently 42% above pre-COVID levels. I suggest that the Cabinet Secretary acquaints himself with this minute. And whilst I'm not a fan of private medicine, simply cutting off that valuable capacity that would help us catch up without having anything in its place is simply unforgivable. The Cabinet Secretary's predecessor used the private sector to bolster capacity in the NHS. It is short-sighted to end it when that capacity is clearly still required because it might make the difference between somebody living or dying. Finally, Presiding Officer, I want to turn to social care. Care homes were at the epicentre of the pandemic and more than a third of all deaths were recorded there. Social care staff put themselves in danger to care for our older people. They did so with inadequate PPE, without testing being available, with ever-changing guidance. We can never thank them enough for their bravery, but clapping for them is not good enough. This is a predominantly low-paid female workforce, but we can change that. We can value social care staff. Labour's amendment repeats our budget call. Pay them £12 an hour now, then move to £15 an hour over the lifetime of the Parliament. The Greens voted against it in the budget, but then put it in their manifesto. And I welcome that change of heart. The money is there to do it. Almost £1 billion is sitting in the Scottish Government's coffers, unallocated. It would more than cover this. There would be plenty left over to also fund an urgent increase in cancer care. And the Cabinet Secretary, I recognise, wants to do the best. Maybe he should start by doing that. He has a tough job ahead. He has to steer through the legislation to create a national care service. Labour proposed this 10 years ago and Nicola Sturgeon rejected it. I suspect she did so, Presiding Officer, because the idea came from us. Well, paying social care workers £15 an hour is another Labour idea. Let's not wait 10 years to implement it. Do it now, transform the social care sector and show you really do care about our older people.
Ms Bailey, I'm not sure... A second admonition in the space of an afternoon. Thank you very much, Ms Bailey. I now call on Gillian Mackay to speak for the Green Party. 4 minutes, Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and welcome to your new role. I welcome the commitment from the Scottish Government to produce an NHS recovery plan within the first 100 days. It's great to see tackling waiting times on the Cabinet Secretary's agenda, but those who have been waiting for a long time for treatment will want to see this acted on quickly. While the speed with which the Government wants to work is very welcome, the remobilisation must be sustainable and not push an already tired workforce to breaking point. Establishing mental health support and additional staff for services such as cancer screening and GP appointments must rise in line with demand to ensure our current workforce feel that the sentiment expressed in this chamber can be turned into action. I again want to thank our incredible health and social care workforce and have witnessed firsthand in the last 6 months the amazing kindness, strength and empathy they have shown in the face of this pandemic. As many in the chamber will be aware, we lost my mum in December and my grandpa just over 2 months ago. Without the nurses at the stroke ward at Forth Valley Royal Hospital, we wouldn't have had those last few precious phone calls with mum. I'm forever in their debt, and I will fight for the working conditions they and all their colleagues deserve. We must take this opportunity to transform the way we look at healthcare in Scotland. In recent times, our NHS has been a national sick service. I hope that this Parliament and some creative thinking, we can move towards a truly national health service. We will have challenges, long COVID and the backlog of screening and surgeries to name a few, but we can start embedding system change now. We also have to look at the drivers of poor health and seek to address them working across portfolios, which is something we as a Parliament maybe haven't been the best at previously. Let's take advantage of a fresh session and sort that. We, and I mean we as MSPs, have to look at how we solve the drivers of poor health. Air pollution, access to good food, housing and poverty all have an impact on our health and well-being. According to the NRS, those living in the most deprived areas of Scotland may die up to 10.5 years younger than those living in our most affluent communities. Poverty and poor health are intrinsically linked, and this is a cycle we have to break for the good of generations to come. Low wages that force families into food banks have to be eliminated, and hungry children should be prioritised over bonuses and tax breaks for wealthy individuals. I absolutely welcome the establishment of a National Care Service, and again, as many of you know, it's an issue close to my heart. My grandpa received wonderful care, and his carer's work allowed me to continue to be his pal for his final few months. So to James and the rest of his carers, I can never say thank you enough. But Gramps had me on a promise to make sure that both paid and unpaid carers are looked after. Another promise I made during the election was to the many disabled people that we all met. I promised to be a voice for them, and I wish to fulfil part of that now by challenging the Cabinet Secretary for Health to make a commitment to actively listen to and crucially act upon the input of disabled people, their families and other service users when designing our National Care Service. We need to make a service that has human rights at its heart and allows them to live to their full potential. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mackay. Before calling Alex Cole-Hamilton, could I remind all members who wish to speak in this debate to press your request to speak buttons if you've not already done so. And I call Alex Cole-Hamilton to speak on behalf of the Scottish Liberal Democrats. 4 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I warmly welcome you to your place? It's great to see you up there. Before I begin, can I also thank the Health Secretary for bringing this debate to Parliament so swiftly in this parliamentary term, and indeed for the inclusive way that he's reached out across the aisle in the first days of his tenure. 2 weeks ago, I received my first dose of the AstraZeneca jab. My constituency is home to 3 vaccination centres, and I got my jag from a constituent that I have helped with unrelated casework. It's wonderful how small a village Edinburgh can feel sometimes. She was one of the first to volunteer with the vaccine programme. And it's no understatement, Presiding Officer, to suggest that the work of our vaccinators is truly remarkable. And it gives us all such hope that through their efforts, the nightmare of COVID-19 may finally be coming to an end. As such, it is right that we should now start to devote parliamentary time to the remobilisation of the NHS and the much-needed reform of our social care service. But Liberal Democrats cannot support this government motion unamended. Whilst much of its sentiment is laudable, we do not support the establishment of a National Care Service, because whilst social care is unquestionably in need of reform in this country, and it needs parity of investment, we do not believe that the management and the control of that reform should lie in the establishment of another centralised bureaucracy. The motion also implies that the principal source of delay in treatment that our patients experience is the pandemic. But the coronavirus emergency has certainly made a bad situation worse. But this government was failing patients long before anyone had ever heard of COVID-19. Presiding Officer, I have lost count of the number of patients who have come to my surgery clutching letters advising of them of their right, their legal right, that this government enshrined in law to be seen in 12 weeks when there isn't a hope of them being seen in 50. Nevertheless, I am glad that this motion begins to acknowledge the backlog created in both our mental and physical health service and aims to redress this balance. But it's simply not good enough to aim for pre-pandemic standards. We must do better with proper workforce planning, major investment, particularly in mental health services and in screening services. Because, as we know, cancer has remained the biggest cause of death in Scotland. Even when the COVID-19 virus was at its peak, cancer did not slow down during the pandemic, but diagnosis rates did. In 2020, cases of cancer in Scotland fell sharply, and for several months, national screening services for breast and bowel cancer and cervical cancer were stopped completely. The impact of this is still being felt now. As of March this year, the number of people on waiting lists for this vital diagnostic test is 25% higher than it was last year. Now, awaiting a cancer diagnosis test is not only physically dangerous, but the mental strain that it puts on patients and their families cannot be overstated. As the Scottish Government attempt to tackle these huge waiting lists, they must do so in a way that will lead to long-term improvement in cancer services so that no one is facing long and traumatic waits to receive that diagnosis. Now, in February, by backing the Liberal Democrat motion, this Parliament declared a national health emergency, a crisis indeed. And a recent survey of over 1,000 people underscored the extent of that emergency. It found that 13% of those who tried to speak to their GP about their mental health during the pandemic had been unsuccessful. And, Presiding Officer, we learned this morning that since Christmas, in the field of child and adolescent mental health, the list of children waiting more than a year for first-line support has grown by a third. As I conclude, Presiding Officer, I want to thank the Government for its commitment to mesh survivors. It enjoys the support of every party in this chamber to that end. And I want to restate my admiration for all our NHS and social care staff for the work they've done for us and will continue to do for us. This is one of the fundamental challenges set to us in this session of Parliament. It should command parliamentary time in nearly every week that we sit. And whilst we may disagree on how to get there, Liberal Democrats will play a constructive part on that journey. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole Hamilton. Could I now call Audrey Nicol? Members will wish to be aware this is Ms. Nicol's first speech in the Parliament. Ms. Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's truly an honour to be elected to this special place as our nation begins its recovery from COVID-19. My grateful thanks to my campaign team, my loving family, activists and all my constituents in Aberdeen South and North Kincardine. I pay special tribute to Maureen Watt, the First Minister for Mental Health, for her lifetime commitment to the constituency. She'll be a very hard act to follow. I will shamelessly big up Aberdeen South and North Kincardine, home to a thriving food and drinks industry, higher education, innovation and stunning coastlines. But it's also the home to a global energy sector. However, the sector is now experiencing a significant downturn, placing jobs and livelihoods at risk. This situation has been compounded by the pandemic and a disastrous Brexit and created a perfect storm that has had a profound effect on many, specifically their mental health. Following a 31-year policing career, I joined the School of Nursing, Midwifery and Paramedic Practice at the Robert Gordon University, delivering nurse education across the health and policing intersect. Never did I imagine that while lecturing to my first years on global health challenges, weeks later they would be facing the prospect of their first placements on the front line of one. I pay tribute to them all, to all NHS staff and all my colleagues who also returned to the front line. I pay tribute to former colleagues in the emergency services, particularly Police Scotland, who had to balance daily law enforcement duties using emergency COVID legislation and responding to the growing demand from mental health distress. Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to focus my first speech on mental health in support of this motion today. Even the most resilient of us felt the mental health impact of the pandemic. But for young adults, those on low incomes and others, the impact was significant, especially where access to care, treatment and psychological therapies was curtailed. The Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan builds on work already underway in response to COVID-19, and I welcome the range of engagement that informed the priorities within it. I am pleased that addressing CAMHS waiting times will be prioritised and programmes such as distress brief interventions will be rolled out. In this Dementia Awareness Week, many of my constituents will welcome the commitment to ensure equitable access to mental health support for older people. I very much hope mental health will be at the centre of the NHS recovery plan set out in this motion today. Presiding Officer, public service is what I know, it's who I am, and over many years I have seen health and social care converge every day to make people's lives better. A national care service is a turning point in our commitment to social care as an investment for us, not a burden on us, offering the opportunity to deliver high-quality, accessible care designed around people's rights and needs. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, people in my constituency and across Scotland answered the call to action in the dark days of the pandemic. The Inchgarth COVID Support Project, Seafine Food Bank, Cove Woodland Trust and others all played their part in supporting mental well-being. I now give them my commitment that I will work as hard as I can across the Chamber and with the Cabinet Secretary to support the Scottish Government deliver the actions set out in both the Mental Health Recovery Plan and the ambitious NHS recovery plan at the heart of this motion today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Nicholl. I now call on Jackson Carla, who will be followed by Emma Ruddick. Mr Carla.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. May I welcome you to your position. And can I begin by congratulating Audra Nicholl on her debut speech. I look forward to hearing more from her as the Parliament progresses. There, of course, is an enormous challenge to deal with in relation to COVID recovery, both its own consequences and ongoing complications. We know of the backlog on cancer and mental health, and I hope to work as non-belligerently as possible with the Cabinet Secretary to resolve these issues, because we all understood that in postponing many of these things, we were compounding a problem, but we should also recognise that there was a problem already there to compound, and that there is a huge challenge and task ahead of us. But one of those issues, and I referred to it when I welcomed the Cabinet Secretary to his position, is the future on development of MESH, because it too was partially and understandably postponed following the meeting that the First Minister had in November 2019 with MESH survivors. And I understand it's slightly peripheral in some ways to today's debate, so if I ask some specific questions, I hope maybe the Cabinet Secretary will contact me afterwards to update me on some of the points I might want to ask today. He is in fact the fifth Health Secretary in the third Parliament to have to contemplate tackling the consequences of the worldwide MESH scandal. A wholly self-inflicted health crisis in countries everywhere, and in Scotland one amplified by the heroic efforts of some heroic women who brought this forward and allowed Scotland to become almost a beacon for people across the world in trying to advance the way in which we approach response to MESH. But let's remember, it cost lives, the first Eileen Baxter, and it ruined lives. And it therefore is fundamentally important that in this Parliament we resolve the issue finally. Firstly, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary about the case record review that was announced by his predecessor on the 10th of February? I did ask the First Minister at First Minister's Questions before Parliament ended if the terms were going to be amended as Professor Alison Britton was requesting, and I believe I understand that they have now been agreed. And I also asked and hoped that Dr. Wael Agar, who has enormous confidence of many of the MESH women, be included in this process. And I'm delighted to say he's contacted me to say the Scottish Government have now invited him to work with Professor Britton. So both those things are welcome, but I'd be interested to know the timetable for the case record review now underway. Secondly, on the 24th of March, and to the absolute delight of the MESH survivors, his predecessor, Jean Freeman, announced that there would be a bill introduced, and I quote, as a priority early in the next session, which would offer retrospective payment and restitution to those women who have travelled out with the United Kingdom, principally to Dr. Veronicus in the United States, for the costs associated with their operations. And I would very much welcome the Cabinet Secretary confirming when early in the next session he intends this bill to absolutely be introduced, because these women have waited long enough, they've suffered long enough, and I know that they are looking forward for this as quickly as possible. Thirdly, there is to be a consultation on the Patient Safety Commissioner, and I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary could confirm what the status of that is. And finally, can I say this? We now know that MESH extends way beyond a calamity for women. Women were organised and were able to bring this issue to the fore, but 10,000 hernia MESH operations using exactly the same materials take place in Scotland every year. They affect men, women and children. Some have died, some have suffered the same horrendous consequences. So finally, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if he intends to ensure that there is a much wider review now of the use and application of MESH within the health service in order that we can draw an end to the scandal and the damage it is doing to thousands of our fellow Scots?
Thank you, Mr Carlo. Could I now call Emma Ruddick to speak? She will be followed by Carol Mochan. And again, the Chamber might wish to be aware that this is Emma Ruddick's first speech.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. You know, if you told me a few years ago that I would be working in Edinburgh this afternoon, I'd probably have been a bit upset, because I would assume you meant that I had moved out of the Highlands. I certainly wouldn't have assumed that I would be in this place representing the biggest and best of our parliamentary regions. From Unst to Campbellton, Lewis to Keith, the scale of it is immense, and it is a true honour and a privilege to represent it. This fact overwhelms me every time I leave the region I now speak for to get the train down here, and again when I see the Keswick Bridge lights in the distance on my way home. I hope that thanks to our new virtual provisions, that journey won't always be necessary, and I might be able to attend this chamber from Skye or Sutherland or Shetland from time to time. I'm glad not to have to say any goodbyes to the person who held this seat for the SNP before myself, because Marie Todd has been returned as a constituency MSP and moved to the health brief, which I know she will be very excited about. I'm delighted to see that this brief includes specific responsibility for women's health, which comes with enormous opportunities, and I hope that during our health recovery, she will take those opportunities to tackle shortcomings in the treatment and management of endometriosis, menopause, in trans health care, and in access to abortion, which is free of obstruction and harassment. I also look forward to working with Kevin Stewart in his new role as Minister for Mental Health, particularly at a time where the Scottish Government has announced a 25% increase in mental health spend. You can expect a good few emails from me. Usually, when you hear me speak about my region, I will be gushing about its beauty or its bakers or our broad accents. But one thing often hidden in the chat about the Straths and Glens is the looming mental health crisis that we face there. It's an issue across Scotland, but the three areas with the highest suicide rates in the country are in the Highlands and Islands. And that can be easy to miss amongst the many articles about how Inverness or Orkney are the most beautiful or happiest places to live. We can use that to brag to and bring in tourists, but that outlook is of no comfort to the people who are looking lonely out of their window at the scenery, considering whether or how to take their own life. I don't make a secret of the fact that I have mental health issues myself, and I strongly believe we need to get real about the things which are making people ill in the Highlands and Islands. Lack of transport, lack of affordable housing and jobs, lack of the right mental health services in the right places. Red Deer and snow in the Ben can't cure depression, but isolation certainly fosters it. And at no time is that more important than when we think about those who've been unable to travel to their nearest neighbour over 5 miles away for much of the last year. Or when we think about those who lost the friends and family that they couldn't visit last Christmas and then didn't get the closure of a well-attended funeral and wake. The £18 million provided for mental health challenges created by the pandemic was very welcome, but even before COVID struck, 16.6 people per 100,000 in Scotland completed suicide in 2019. As we recover from one pandemic, we underestimate the magnitude of the other one at our own risk. Now, the enormity of the job facing me is about as large as the region itself, and that is not lost on me. I do love the Highlands and Islands, but I've also suffered a mental health illness in it. So I will spend the next 5 years doing everything in my power to improve the lives of others who make it their home, working with colleagues across this chamber to ensure we are getting it right. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Roddick. Could I now call on Carol Mochan to speak, and she will be followed by Emma Harper. And again, the Chamber will wish to be aware that this is Carol Mochan's first speech. Ms Mochan.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. And before I begin my first speech, might I say what a privilege it is to be here speaking on behalf of my home region, south of Scotland. I fully intend to use my time here in Parliament to stand up for the ordinary people of this country and those communities so often ignored by a political class, often distant from the lives of their constituents. I came here to get things done, and that is what the people of the south of Scotland elected me to do. So I think it is important we understand why so little has been done over the last decade before we move on to the next round of promises. There is no doubt the campaign we all just fought did not give as much attention to the desperate state of care, the NHS and mental health services as I would have liked. And as such, I welcome the fact a plan will eventually be brought here to the Chamber to deal with these matters. In this debate, I would particularly like to focus on the National Care Service and the concerning way in which carers are treated in this country. In care, the root of the problem is pay. There is no doubt this government is very accomplished at media management, presenting a progressive face to the public and promoting their own narrative. But if that story is not reflected in the pockets of care workers, some of the most overworked people in our country, then it is meaningless. We must also consider that this injustice disproportionately affects women. More often than not, women who have never been blessed with the advantages of family wealth or a second additional income. When you take these factors into account, I have to ask, why has it taken so long for this to become a priority for this government? The pandemic may have highlighted this issue, but it should not have required such a life-defining event to turn our attentions to those who are have been so undervalued for so long. The recent Feeley report takes some important steps forward in tackling this issue, yet it failed to adequately address the chronic levels of low pay and poor terms and conditions experienced by most people working in care. I regularly speak to people of all ages and backgrounds, paid and unpaid, working every hour they can, caring for others, and the message is the same. We are struggling to keep our head above waters. It is time we started taking carers and a national care service seriously. But a national care service has to be worthy of the name and involve patients, carers, trade unions and local government from the outset. We can't keep building institutions from the top down and expect them to meet the needs of people at the bottom. Cabinet Secretary, rather than talking about the esteem a national care service will be held in, let's be clear about the financial commitment to it. Because if you want world-class public services, you have to pay for them. When Labour created the NHS, Britain led the world in socialised health. It was a complete shift in the lives of the whole country. I see no reason why we cannot aim for that sort of momentous change again. I hope that today is used as an opportunity for the government to listen and take on board this genuine scepticism about any plans they have put forward to reform of health. Why? Because they have been in power for 14 years, and during that time, we have seen the NHS becoming worryingly underfunded, understaffed, and as other colleagues have remarked upon, waiting times are now at concerningly high levels. Just this morning, I spoke to Sam H about the concerning waits for children and young people to CAM services, an ongoing issue that must seek urgent attention. In my final few seconds, though, I return to the issue of carers. I ask the government to be honest with them. The latest Barnett consequentials provide Scotland with around £700 million for the health and social care budget. It seems sensible that the lion's share of that is spent on giving care staff a serious pay rise. I urge you to support Scottish Labour and the trade union movement's call for carers to receive £15 an hour. In my own region, that would make a vast difference to the lives of so many people. Let's achieve something meaningful straight out of the gate, right away, and let's send a message today from this new Parliament. Let's pay back those we owe so much. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ms Mochan. I call Emma Harper, who will be followed by Dr Sandis Gulhani. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this important debate on the health recovery, and I welcome the Cabinet Secretary and Mental Health Minister Kevin Stewart to their roles. The past 15 months has been an unprecedented time for us all, and the health and well-being, the social and financial challenges that have been experienced has been extremely difficult for many, including our healthcare workforce. Now that NHS Scotland has made rapid changes during the COVID pandemic, we do now have an opportunity to accelerate reform. And I thank everyone for their commitment and their work in the multidisciplinary team approaches so far. For this afternoon, I will focus my comments on four key points which have particular relevance to health reform in Dumfries and Galloway in the south-west of Scotland, in my South Scotland region. These are cancer treatment pathways, travel reimbursement, and the SNP's manifesto commitment for an agency for remote and rural medicine, and the Respiratory Care Action Plan. Presiding Officer, I've raised D&G's NHS cancer treatment pathways previously on many occasions. And in D&G, it's part of South East Cancer Network, which is the SCAN network in Scotland. Current treatment pathways mean that patients in Wigtonshire and the rest of D&G who require, for example, radiotherapy as part of their treatment, they go to Edinburgh. They're referred to Edinburgh, which means a 260-mile round trip instead of going to Glasgow, which is a 150-mile round trip. Nowhere in D&G is in the south-east of Scotland. The previous Cabinet Secretary said patients should be offered a choice for place of treatment. So I would ask if the Cabinet Secretary could provide assurances, whether it's later or in future correspondence, that patients are informed about their choice for place of treatment, including treatment closer to home. Additionally, persons in NHS and Fraser Galloway are only reimbursed for travel using a means-tested model, while alternatively, people in the Highlands and Islands and Ayrshire and Arran are eligible for full reimbursement for journeys over 30 miles and even overnight supported accommodation. I raised both of these issues, travel reimbursement and treatment pathway place, previously, and the former Health Secretary agreed for the Government to carry out a review. So I would ask whether this review has been completed and what changes for treatment pathways and reimbursement will be made as part of any health reform. My constituents in the west of Dumfries and Galloway will be very happy to hear about any positive steps to change current processes. Presiding Officer, good news is the SNP has a commitment for a centre of excellence for rural and remote medicine and health, health and social care. This aim is to provide expertise and advice on the delivery of care in different rural, island and remote settings across Scotland. I would be grateful if the Cabinet Secretary could provide any further detail on how this rural centre of excellence will be taken forward. I have no doubt that a rural centre for medicine and the brand new Fast Track Cancer Diagnosis Centre, which is up and running in Dumfries, will undoubtedly help many people in the remote areas of Dumfries and Galloway with their health care issues. Presiding Officer, more good news is the commitment for the Respiratory Care Action Plan to be implemented, the RCAP. I was Lung Health Cross Party Group convener in 2016 and not long out of my prior job as a nurse, and I called for a plan which could tackle issues relating to smoking, COPD and the very important issue of obstructive sleep apnea, which is the first lung health issue which will be addressed in the RCAP. This is hugely welcome, particularly in dealing with long COVID, and I look forward to seeing how this is rolled out and implemented. And I welcome the Government's commitment on this and Dr Tom Farden and his team for taking this forward. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I welcome this motion and debate today and the health recovery steps that have already been taken forward by the Scottish Government, and I look forward to positive engagement with the Cabinet Secretary in the future. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ms Harper. I now call Dr Sandis Gulhani, who will be followed by Eleanor Witham. Dr Gulhani.
What would you do if your teenage daughter told you she was feeling low and upset? That she had cut herself to make the pain go away? That she has thoughts of not wanting to be here anymore? Unfortunately, these presentations are not isolated or rare. I hear these concerns all too frequently. This is a girl who has reached crisis, but she is in need of urgent help. But it is not a gradual process that patients go through to arrive at crisis. One does not simply happen upon crisis. We need to recognise these initial symptoms and act sooner to help. To do this, we need to spend the money allocated by the government wisely, and a children's wellbeing practitioner would be an astute step. These practitioners already exist in England, so we do not need to reinvent the wheel. They intervene with early signs of behavioural difficulties and self-esteem issues. They work with patients and parents and prevent our children from reaching crisis, which is needed as latest figures show 2,000 kids in Scotland waiting a year for treatment. The NHS is under strain. In general practice, we have never worked harder, never seen such demand, never felt we were stretched so thin. Treating 50 patients a day, plus referrals, plus paperwork, plus results, we barely get time to eat lunch or go to the toilet. We work many more hours than we're supposed to. My colleagues across the NHS do the same, with hundreds of thousands of unpaid extra hours worked because we are dedicated to our patients. But we are burning out. We need every second we have allocated with each patient to give them the best care we can. So I would like an assurance from the Cabinet Secretary that he will guarantee that as set out in the motion stating the Scottish Government will increase day case and outpatient activity by 10%, we will not achieve this by reducing the amount of time allocated for clinicians to see patients. In my maiden speech, I spoke about long COVID. Now, I'm not going to stand here and pick through the mismanagement of the pandemic, because to find fault is easy. To do better may be more difficult. But do better we must. Deputy Presiding Officer, for our country, for our health service, for these patients. Long COVID is a novel, multi-system disease that causes brain fog, depression, heart and lung issues, fatigue, being denied basic functions we all take for granted. To talk, to laugh, to breathe. It affects between 10 to 35% of everyone that contracts COVID. Of everyone. We do not know how, we do not know why, we do not know how to treat it effectively. The UK government has provided new funding in England to set up COVID clinics. The Hertfordshire model is what I would like to recreate here in Scotland, to give us a multidisciplinary team of GPs, hospital doctors, physios, psychologists, OTs, dietitians, pain management teams, all working together and cooperatively to give these patients hope. Something that has been lacking in their lives since falling victim to the COVID crisis. We want to improve and optimise recovery outcomes and reduce comorbidity. To do this, we need new funding to help tens, if not hundreds of thousands of patients. So I hope the Cabinet Secretary agrees with me that we need to commit new money to fund long COVID clinics. So, Cabinet Secretary, as in my referrals, I summarised my key points for clarity, and I thought that I would do this here. As you've said, your door is always open. After your speech, I see you recognise long COVID, but hope you agree with me that we need to provide new money to fund clinics here in Scotland, not add it to a burnt-out GP workforce that already has an unsustainable workload. We cannot cut the time clinicians have with patients to facilitate this 10% improvement. And can he assure me of this? And finally, I hope he agrees with me that to create a children's wellbeing practitioner would be a good step.
Thank you. I call Elena Whittam, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I may take this opportunity to welcome you to your new role. It is a huge honour and a privilege to be here in our Scottish Parliament representing the good folk of Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley, a wonderful constituency featuring some of the most beautiful rural and coastal scenery in Scotland, but also somewhere blessed with tight-knit communities who have tremendous spirit and ingenuity in the face of many challenges. This community's spirit was certainly to the fore this past year as we all grappled with the reality of the pandemic, and my heartfelt thanks goes out to the tireless volunteers from the many social enterprises and community groups throughout the constituency who adapted and responded with hard graft to make sure that their fellow residents were fed and supported in the darkest of days. I also need to take a moment to thank my predecessor, the wonderful and tireless Jean Freeman. I share the feelings of our new Cabinet Secretary for Health as I seek to fill the big shoes that she's left behind, with a wee bit of trepidation and a whole lot of awe. Thank you to my hard-working election agent Paul Cairns and the entire team who on election day dealt with a freak snowstorm in Muirkirk and a hailstorm like no other in Catrin. I had hailstones down my boots for the rest of the day. And thank you to the thousands in Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley who ventured out to cast their votes. I take my responsibility as your representative here very seriously indeed, and I will work hard for you each and every single day. My whole working life has been one of seeking to address inequalities and champion social justice, including spending a decade as a women's aid worker. And for this reason, I was delighted to see that in her new ministerial team, the First Minister has included a Minister for Women's Health. Women and girls face significant barriers to good mental and physical health, and having a minister to take forward the already considerable work of the Women's Health Group and the Women's Health Plan, I'm confident that as a country, we will finally see an end to women's health inequalities. For too many years, policy creation and research parameters have sidelined the well-being needs of women and girls. Many illnesses affect women significantly differently than men. For an example, take heart conditions and strokes. They present themselves in an entirely different way in women, and yet many women, and indeed their own doctors, often miss the signs of serious illness, which left untreated can be catastrophic. We also need to be aware of how intersectionality affects women's health inequalities. Women from Black and Asian minority ethnic groups, including Scotland's Gypsy Travellers, have a much higher incidence of maternal and neonatal deaths. And lesbian and bisexual women experience a much higher rate of breast cancer. And as I know from my working life, domestic abuse is a high risk factor for depression, substance abuse, and a whole host of physical disorders. For the many women I supported in refuge, they carried with them decades of unmet mental and physical health needs. Neurodiversity also presents itself in a very different way in young girls, and they often find themselves as grown women before somebody finally diagnoses their autism spectrum disorder or their ADHD. This can mean that the already fraught teenage years can become almost unbearable for girls who have no diagnosis nor the tools that they need to enable them to live their best lives. This is something that I have direct experience of, and I see firsthand how easily recognised signs and symptoms can be missed if we are always seeking to see the male version of a condition. Finally, I also welcome the creation of a new early cancer diagnostic centre in Ayrshire as part of our NHS recovery plan, which is set to open imminently. We lost my mum at only 58 a few years ago to a late diagnosis of lung cancer. Like many women, she put her symptoms down to being tired due to her caring responsibilities for my gran, who had dementia, and she put her worries to the back of her mind with devastating consequences. Like others who spoke before me, I must put on record my sincere thanks to the staff and staff nurses at Crosshouse Hospital who looked after her, for her in those short few weeks. Deputy Presiding Officer, the pandemic has laid bare and shone a light on inequalities, and it is only right that our health recovery plan seeks to address them. And I look forward to seeing how our newly acquired East Ayrshire Community Hospital in my own constituency plays a valuable role in this. Thank you.
Thank you. I believe that was Ms. Wishman's first speech to our Parliament today. And our last speaker in the open debate will be Sarah Boyack. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and welcome to your new post. I'd like to begin by recognising, as other colleagues have, the tireless work of our health and care staff, both before and during the pandemic, but especially now as we recover and we rebuild. So we need the Scottish Government to take on board the Labour amendment put forward by Jackie Bailey that calls for an immediate pay rise to £12 an hour for care workers, rising to £15 an hour over this term, but also effective engagement with NHS unions to ensure that all of our health and care professionals' work is rewarded and that they are supported with their vital contribution. I want to focus today on the crossover between health and social care and the need to ensure that no one who finds themselves at crossover is missing out on the care, the treatment or the support they need. So I'm delighted with the fact that the Scottish Government will finally be pressing forward with Labour's National Care Service. From the outset, this service must be as fair to staff and users and accessible to people that need it. Last week, a constituent from Midlothian reached out to me for support. Her father has dementia, and as a family, they've been struggling to meet his care needs, particularly as his symptoms worsen. And as many who live with a dementia suffer, this has been a constant source of worry and concern. And it's been made worse by waiting lists for dementia beds and places in care homes and the absence of a social worker. And she told me that at times, because of his dementia, her father's behaviour has become incredibly challenging, even though he has antipsychotic medication, which means that when his symptoms are manageable, he's not his normal self, and the family feel like they're firefighting the symptoms, not treating the cause. And they were also advised that should he have a flare-up, they should call the police or to take him to A&E. A horrible solution to find yourself in, a situation to find yourself in, but not a solution. Now, thankfully, at the end of last week, after a long wait, they got a temporary respite place, and the family were appointed a social worker to support them through the next steps they need for long-term care. Now, they have praised everybody that supported them, but their experience shows the stress and the anxiety that exists in the crossover between health and social care, as well as the restraints on professionals trying to do their best. So as we move out from this pandemic, prioritising NHS recovery, building our National Care Service, we need to see that examples like the one I've described today are used to help design a better service, the best possible service for those receiving health and social care and their families and loved ones, so that no one falls through a gap. And we cannot go back to the delayed discharge crisis we had before the pandemic. So we need step-down care, accessible homes adapted to meet people's needs, and care staff treated with respect, with national terms and conditions, and our councils properly funded. That is essential in moving forward so that people get the support they need when they need it. Finally, I want to raise the issue that was a massive issue for us in Edinburgh before we had the election. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary. I hope that he will commit to fully funding a new eye hospital in Edinburgh, following the First Minister's promises during our election campaign. Yesterday, retired eye specialists raised their concerns that NHS Lothian could fail to back the plans that they had worked up with money that has paid for this from the Scottish Government to ensure a new eye hospital at Little France. As they said, Lothian's ophthalmic patients need a fully equipped and staff eye hospital to replace the crumbling eye pavilion, which is near the end of its useful life. We need a clear commitment and we need it fast. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And we will now move to closing speeches. And I first call on Gillian Mackay to close for the Greens. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd like to give my congratulations to all of those making their first speeches today. Audrey Nicol, Emma Roddick, Carol Mockin and Elena Whittam. It's a nerve-wracking thing, but I think you all did brilliantly, and the depth of talent and expertise in this session's new intake will certainly give some of our party colleagues a run for their money. The way we choose to remobilise our health service will be vital to ensure that we have a healthy population going forward. Our health service must always be in public hands and given the resources it needs. Primary care, including GP practices and community pharmacies, represents 90% of patient contact with the NHS and plays a central role in the health of the nation. Support must be directed here and at screening programmes quickly to ensure no one is missed. People should be supported to live the healthiest lives possible. Prevention and early intervention is key to achieving this, as is tackling the root cause of poor health, such as poverty, air pollution, poor access to food, and other things such as smoking. Building a truly national health service is something that requires cross-portfolio working and a different approach to things than we've sometimes been used to. But we can do difficult things, and this is our opportunity in this building to start that hard work. Mental health has been repeatedly mentioned today, and I thank those who have shared their own experience of their mental health. CAM services are undoubtedly in crisis, waiting times for services are long, and we're trying to deal with complex needs, often through a set number of sessions of CBT. This isn't a service that's currently set up to give people the therapy and support they need. Many practitioners are seeing people being referred multiple times as the number of CBT sessions offered are not enough. The number of sessions offered often depend on a waiting list length and are very much subject to a postcode lottery. This needs addressed, and I look forward to working with the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister for Mental Health on this. Presiding Officer, we will be supporting the Labour amendment at decision time. We committed to supporting a £15 minimum wage for social care in our manifesto, and we did this because we know the critical role social care staff play, and we understand how demanding and skilled jobs in this sector are, and that they're predominantly done by women. We believe they should be remunerated accordingly. But we also understand this cannot be done as quickly as we would all like, and a broader debate needs to be had about the development of a transition to a national care service and how we pay for it. We will not be supporting the Conservative amendment, as the deletion of a commitment to the National Care Service is not something that we can support. We will also be supporting the motion. The Cabinet Secretary has laid out an ambitious plan within this motion, and my aim is to robustly hold him to account and, where I can, push him further to do everything we can to support Scotland's health and wellbeing bounce back from this pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Paul O'Kane to wind up for Labour, and this is Mr O'Kane's first speech to the Parliament.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and may I begin by welcoming you to your role. It is an honour to be able to make my first speech in this chamber and to close for Scottish Labour in this important debate on our health recovery. Like others have done, may I begin by welcoming the Cabinet Secretary and the ministerial team of Marie Todd and Kevin Stewart to their roles, along indeed with all our new shadow spokespeople across the chamber. This is a time like no other, and collectively we must rise to the challenges that lie before us. There will, of course, be times when we disagree, but there is also much common cause as we support our NHS to recover and we build the social care services we need for the future. May I also commend colleagues across the Chamber who have made first speeches today. I think we have begun to see the breadth and depth of what the 2021 intake will bring to our debates in this place, and I do hope that my own contribution this afternoon will continue in that vein. Presiding Officer, I hope that the Chamber will indulge me for a moment, as is the custom, whilst I thank my family, especially my parents and my brother, my friends, party activists, and everyone who has believed in me and supported me to be elected to this place. I have to make a particular mention for my partner, Alan, whom, COVID permitting, and 1 year late in August, will be my husband. Colleagues can expect some questions from me on the regulations covering weddings, and I hope that they will forgive me for that particular declaration of interest. It's an honour to represent West Scotland and the communities where I grew up and still live today, and the communities that have shaped me, from Neilston and Barrhead to Kirkintilloch and Port Glasgow. And I want to take a moment just to pay tribute to those retiring members from West Scotland who have served with distinction over many years. To Mary Fee, particularly for her sterling work on equalities and human rights. Mary's work for the rights of Gypsy travellers in Scotland is something I believe we should all take inspiration from as we move forward with a recovery that works for everyone. To Ken McIntosh, so much has been said about Ken already, but Ken is a great friend of mine and someone who has always encouraged me ever since I first delivered leaflets for him. As Jax and Carla will attest to in my early teens, it was a great joy to be sworn in by Ken 3 weeks ago, or 4 weeks ago now, and he served our parliament, our communities in Eastwood and West Scotland, and indeed our country, I think, with diligence, integrity and kindness, something that can be all too lacking from our politics at times. Upon my election to this place, I remarked that when I was growing up, there were times that I was worried that I wouldn't be accepted for who I was, that life would always be hard, and that discrimination and hurtful words would just be something that I had to accept. But there are two great things that gave me cause for hope as a teenager. The first was exceptional teachers at my high school, St Luke's and Barrhead, who saw me for who I was, who genuinely cared, and who always taught me to be myself, my best self. In many ways, like countless other educators, they understood the real importance of supporting the mental health and well-being of young people, long before perhaps we had started to meaningfully discuss the far-reaching impact of poor mental health for children and young people across Scotland. And the second was this place, our Scottish Parliament. On the cusp of becoming a teenager and realising that I was gay, the battles around the repeal of Section 28 raged across our society. On our television sets and through our letterboxes came the message that there was something inherently wrong and dangerous about LGBT people, and that pretended family relationships had no place in our schools. I heard the anger, the hate, and the downright mistruths that were told about people like me, and I was terrified. And then people stood up in our new Scottish Parliament and said aloud that the new Scotland, in the fledgling days of devolution, would be a place where inclusion, respect and equality were the hallmarks. People like Wendy Alexander and Donald Dewar, and of course, my now colleague on these benches, Jackie Bailey. That is the power of this Parliament, the power to choose, the power to make things right, the power to say to teenagers like me, you have a place, you belong, you will be safe, and we will stand up for you, for all of your hopes, your dreams and ambitions. As Dewar put it, more than our politics and our laws, who we are, how we carry ourselves. This debate today, the long discourse we will have about recovery from the pandemic, must be about who we are and how we carry ourselves. Over 10,000 of our fellow citizens have lost their lives in the pandemic. And whilst we have heard that figure often in this chamber, each represents a person who loved and was loved. And again, our condolences are with anyone who has lost someone. Presiding Officer, we must ask ourselves, how will we help carry those who are left behind? Those who are already struggling with physical health conditions or poor mental health before the pandemic. The 10,618 waiting over 18 weeks for mental health services. The 1 in 5 young people still being rejected from CAM services. The 28,000 people who have waited over a year for treatment or surgery. The missing cancer diagnosis, the more than 100,000 people waiting anxiously for a diagnostic test, the social care workers overworked and feeling undervalued,
These COVID heroes, whom we all applauded each Thursday night, but who were only offered a 20p uplift from this government, they deserve an immediate pay rise of at least £12 an hour, rising to £15 per hour in this current Parliament. That is something we will work across this chamber to secure, with anyone who shares our view and the views of our trade unions, that after the applause has fallen silent, there must be meaningful action to support our care workers. It is clear, Presiding Officer, that an NHS recovery plan is urgently needed, but we will press the government to ensure that those anxiously awaiting diagnosis and treatment, those who so badly need mental health support, and those workers who gave their all throughout the pandemic are not forgotten. We will use the power of this place to choose, and we will be by their side. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Craig Hoy to wind up for the Conservatives, up to 7 minutes, and this is Mr Hoy's first speech to our Parliament today.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I begin by congratulating you on your new role and by welcoming the Cabinet Secretary and his colleagues to their new positions. This afternoon we have heard powerful speeches, particularly from new members, but also members on all sides of this chamber. Paul O'Kane, who spoke passionately about the challenges of growing up gay. The Cabinet Secretary, who talked about the daunting role that lies ahead of him, and a role that we wish him well as he commences. Emma Roddick, who spoke with passion about the challenge of mental health, including her own challenges. And my colleague, Dr. Sandesh Kulhani, who talked movingly and with first-hand experience about the long COVID challenge that lies ahead in our NHS. And Jackie Bailey, who set out the stark realities of the mental health challenge and the challenge facing our cancer care services. Jackson Carlaw, who rightly set out how we must resolve the mesh scandal during this Parliament through a process of restitution. And of course, my colleague Annie Wells, who noted the progress made against COVID, who thanked our dedicated NHS staff and who warned that there are significant challenges ahead. And can I also thank those new members who have made their maiden contributions, Audrey Nicholl, Carol Mockin, Gillian Mackay and Elena Whittam, who talked with conviction about women's health issues. As a former journalist, I have listened to many maiden speeches, but today is my opportunity to make my first contribution in this Parliament. And I would like to start by paying tribute to Ian Gray. After his final speech here, I wrote to Ian thanking him for his service to East Lothian, and I said that his successor would have very big shoes to fill. Little did I know that it would take three MSPs, Paul McLennan as the constituency member and Martin Whitfield and myself as the regional MSPs, to fill Ian's shoes. It is an honour to be able to represent the south of Scotland. I live in East Lothian, I grew up in Mid Lothian, and my late Granny Hoy was brought up in the Law near Carluke in South Lanarkshire. So the threads of my own family run through the rich and diverse tapestry that is the south of Scotland region. It was there in the Law Village where my great aunt Jenny lived with her brother and sister in a cold, cramped miner's cottage that I first saw political debate. For Jenny was something rare in South Lanarkshire in the early 1980s. She was a Conservative, or in the words of her sister Flora, she was a bloody Tory. But Jenny wasn't that at all. She was what hundreds of thousands of working-class Scots went on to become. People who are ambitious for their families, their friends and their communities. People who stood apart from the old Scottish Labour ways. People who rejected a benign and no doubt well-intentioned socialism, which sadly kept the poor poor and the working classes in their place. And while many families, including my own, moved on and made progress, others did not. Poverty and the harsh health inequalities it causes is a stubborn stain on the character of modern Scotland. And 60 years after deindustrialisation, we still have a chance to break this cycle. Four generations with no hope, no stake in society that they see around them. Many living with chronic health conditions, others with the misery of drug and alcohol misuse. And before COVID, record numbers confronting mental health challenges. Their life choices limited, their life chances blighted, and their life expectancy blunted. Poverty and poor health are the result of public policy failures by a succession of administrations. My own party, Labour, and now 14 years of SNP government in Scotland. So, as we did debate the health recovery, let's not kid ourselves that everything was in a good place under the SNP before the pandemic. The worst rate of drug deaths in the Western world. And we found out today that 2,000 children and young people are waiting over a year to begin vital mental health treatment. And even before COVID, the SNP's waiting time improvement plan was in chaos. In the election, we were clear about the urgency of the health challenge, and I welcome Minister's commitment to an NHS recovery plan. In March, 100,000 Scots were waiting on key diagnostic tests. The cost of misdiagnosis and cancelled operations will be with us for decades. And that's why we called for guaranteed increases in NHS funding for every year of this Parliament. An additional £600 million to tackle the NHS treatment backlog. Outpatient appointments and elective surgery 7 days a week. These are practical proposals to help remobilise our NHS today, not in 100 days. In relation to today's debate, members will note our amendment to the government motion, and I hope that they will give it their consideration and support. But before I conclude, I want to turn to a myth which sadly could dominate this term. That is that this Parliament needs more powers and that Scotland needs to split from the UK to achieve a lasting COVID recovery. The powers to remobilise and revitalise our NHS are already vested in this institution. The levers which control those powers sit there just in front of ministers on that front bench. But that said, let me give the following reassurance on our health recovery. Where ministers reach out and use those powers to full effect and good effect, they can expect the full support of this party in this Parliament for those endeavours. The success of the UK vaccine programme means that the long shadow cast by COVID could now be starting to fade. But no one in this chamber, or in our GP surgeries, or on our hospital wards, should underestimate the scale of the challenge ahead. The Scottish people want an NHS that they can be even more proud of, and we must work as hard as our frontline NHS staff to deliver this. If we work through our political differences, then in 5 years' time, we will be able to look our constituents in the eye and say that we did our best for them. And that, I believe, is all they ask and all they expect from us. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I now call on Kevin Stewart to wind up for the Scottish Government. About 9 minutes, Minister. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I welcome you to your new role? I'm sure you'll be fantastic in it. I'd like to thank everyone today for their valuable and often personal contributions that have made this extremely important debate even better, I think. I'd like to pay tribute to Audrey Nicol, to Emma Roddick, to Carol Mochan, Eleanor Whittam, Paul O'Kane and Craig Hoy for their first speeches. And apologies to the old hands today, but I'm going to mainly concentrate on their contributions and all of the aspects of my portfolio in my closing remarks. We have ambitious plans on mental wellbeing and social care as a core. Improving quality across both offers will be a vital part of our recovery. The health and well-being of individuals and communities at this time is an absolute priority, as many have mentioned in their speeches here today. Recovery in the social sector will only be achieved if we learn the lessons from the pandemic. We must recognise the challenging position that many employers and workers are now facing, and we must seek to improve the offer, services and outcomes to give all recipients the best opportunity to thrive in the future.
Now, many folk have talked about lived experience and their own personal experiences today. And I don't think that we should be afraid to talk about our personal experiences in this place. And we should not be afraid to listen to those folks with lived experience as we formulate the policy for the future. And I fully intend to ensure that we engage everyone that we possibly can in formulating the mental health and social care policies that we need to do. That is the only way that we are going to improve the offer. There has been significant media focus on mental well-being over the last year. And it's important that we recognise that moving forward, there will be a broad range of areas where mental health and well-being in itself may have an impact on our recovery if we don't get things absolutely right. As Mr. Yousaf explained, we are committed to the creation of a National Care Service, backed by an increase of 25% in investment in social care over the term of this Parliament. We will build a world-leading social care system, one which we will be based on fairness, equality and human rights, and it will provide us with the consistency, the equity, the fairness, the national approach and accountabilities we need to improve social care here in Scotland. And in the first 100 days of this administration, we will begin consultation on the legislation required to formulate the National Care Service. And I want as many folk as possible to respond to that consultation. I want you as MSPs to be evangelists to get folk to respond to that consultation so that we have as many people as possible having their say. The aim is to have that legislation introduced into Parliament in its first year. This will not be easy, and we will need to think radically. And this work will be supported by the Social Covenant Steering Group, which will include those with actual lived experience of using care services. The National Care Service will be operational within the five-year lifetime of this Parliament, but we have a lot of work to do. I certainly will give way to Ms. Duncan Glancy.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, and I thank you for taking this intervention, particularly at the late stage in the discussion. Given the very welcome statement that care staff should have parity with health staff, can you outline the mechanisms that you will use to make the £500 payments to the care staff who have yet to receive these, and mainly who are employed through direct payments or ILF and in the third sector, and when they can expect to receive this money?
Minister.
Ms Duncan Glancy makes a very good point, and obviously she will recognise that it was one of the things that was lying on my desk when I first took office. We are doing everything possible to make sure that those payments reach people that should have had them as soon as possible. I've written to the local authorities, to health and social care partnerships already on this issue, and we will do all that we can to make sure that £500 is in their pooches and purses as soon as possible. And I'm sure Ms Duncan Glancy will continue to ask me about that as we move forward. Presiding Officer, I think there are a number of other things which have not been particularly brought up during the course of this debate, but I think that I must touch upon because they have been areas where members of the public have contacted me and I know others, particularly on care home visiting. On care home visiting, I have to say it is my priority to meet with representatives from across the sector to support further progress and improve the quality of visits. I've also written to the Care Inspectorate today to ensure that we are that care homes are following the guidance that we have put in place. And we are committed to strengthening residents' rights in adult residential settings. And this includes working quickly to give effect to Anne's Law, where residents can access their nominated relatives or friends to support their well-being. And delayed discharge has also featured sparingly today. And I'm very well aware of the human cost of delayed discharge and the benefits of ensuring that we address this properly. And I will work with all health and social care partnerships to ensure that this is addressed safely and lawfully. And I have also written to them to this effect. Mental health is an absolute priority for this government. I will, very briefly.
Martin Whitfield.
Been mentioned today, and I wonder whether you could comment on the state of dental affairs here in Scotland, which appears to be in a great crisis, both as a result of COVID, but before that as well. I'm grateful.
Minister, there's time in hand to give you some time back.
I have to say that dental services have improved dramatically over the last number of years. If you take the northeast of Scotland, my own area, folk queued for miles, literally, to get on an NHS dentist's books. That's not the case anymore because we invested in the dental school in the North East. And in our manifesto, the SNP has committed to remove dental charges to ensure equity in the field of patients and dental needs. So I think we will provide Mr. Whitfield with a greater response, but I think we have made a huge advance there. But mental health is an absolute priority for this government, and it has been throughout this pandemic. Our mental health transition and recovery plan outlines our response to the mental health effects of COVID-19, containing over 100 actions. And we're particularly focused on providing the right help and support to anyone whose mental health has been disproportionately affected over the past 15 months. And that plan is supported by a £120 million recovery and renewal fund to transform services. And that's the single biggest investment in mental health in the history of this Parliament. Today, we have the statistics that there are more folk working in our NHS than ever before, some 9,000 more. And we have 80% more folk working in child and adult and adolescent mental health services since we came to power in 2007. But we have a way to go, and we have agreed early priorities for the investment that I've talked about earlier, and have allocated over £34 million to deliver transformational improvements to CAM services and to clear waiting lists, backlogs, for both CAMHS and psychological therapies. I think we have all seen the quarterly statistics published this morning. And I have to say that some board areas are performing much better than others. I want to ensure the export of best practice so we can get the improvements that we need in CAMHS. And I've already started engaging with board chief executives at both ends of the performance spectrum, and will continue to do so across all boards. I think it is absolutely vital that we get this right for our young people. Presiding Officer, I'd like to thank you and everyone for taking part in this debate. The pandemic is far from over, and there is much to be done to support the mental health and social care sectors in their recovery. Our recovery plans must be robust, and they must have people at the centre of them, people who work in the social care and mental health sectors, and people in the community who require their services. As we move forward, we need to continue to listen, and I'm a great believer in ensuring that those with lived experience help formulate policy. As Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care, I am committed, along with my ministerial colleagues, to doing just that. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes the debate on health recovery. We'll have a short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.